Hello, statisticians. Mr. Young Saver here from Skew the Script. Today, we're going to return to the context we explored in class last time, the Flint water crisis, and specifically talk about how researchers used margins of error to reveal the truth about Flint's water, despite officials trying to cover it up. Let's skew it. Today's lessons on critical values and margins of error. This is lesson 7.3 in our course sequence. In 2014, city officials in Flint moved the water supply for the city from the Detroit watershed to the more local Flint River. And you can see pictures here of the city officials celebrating this move because it cut costs, and they celebrated by drinking the local Flint River water. But by 2015, residents started to notice that their water was discolored, had a funny smell to it, and seemed to be generally unsafe. And they complained to city officials that this had happened. But city officials were mostly deaf ears to these complaints. And it got to a point where the mayor of the city went on local television on a news station, drank the tap water live on TV, and said, "Look, it is safe. You have no reason to complain about this water." So with this debate raging on, a team of investigators from Virginia Tech, led by Dr. Mark Edwards, came to Flint to investigate whether the water was safe. So for today's key analysis, we're going to look at how did those researchers design their study to test city officials' claims that the water was safe. If you'd like to follow along using notes, you can print it up from our website at this URL. So let's first talk about what we looked at last time in class, constructing a 95% interval for the situation. Let's recall the EPA lead and copper rule. This rule states that if more than 10% of homes in a city have prominent lead levels, the water system is deemed unsafe and must be changed. So imagine that Dr. Edwards and his team randomly sampled 66 homes, and of those in Flint, 11 had prominent lead levels. This means that 11 out of those 66, 16.7% of their sample had high lead. That's higher than the 10% allowed by the EPA. That suggests that Flint is violating the regulation. But does this evidence convince you that more than 10% of all households have prominent lead levels? We've only measured a sample of 66. It could be that this sample picked up a high share, an unusually high share of lead homes by chance alone. And if we were to go about and measure all the homes in the whole city, we would actually see that the true proportion is a bit lower than 10% having high lead levels. It could be that by chance alone, we got a very high lead sample. But we don't have time to go measure all the homes. So how can we really approach this question? So what we're going to do is create an interval of plausible values for that true proportion based on our sample. What are some plausible values that we would expect? And are those plausible values above 10%? And so what we do is we consider all possible random samples that could have happened. This is the sampling distribution for proportion. If we were to get samples randomly of 66 homes, we did this a bunch of times, what are some proportions that we would be likely to see? So under certain conditions, we know the sampling distribution for proportion is shaped like a normal curve with these parameters listed here. And note, we don't know the true proportion. So when we plug in the true proportion here, we can't really plug that in. That's what we're trying to estimate, the true proportion of all homes that have high lead. And so what we're going to plug in instead is our sample proportion. And this is now called the standard error rather than the standard deviation of this normal curve, because we're using a statistic rather than the parameter to estimate it. So we're going to plug in our best guess for the true proportion, the sample proportion, into this formula. I'm going to go ahead and plug those things in along with the sample size. We measured 66 homes, and we get these estimates for this normal curve. What that standard error of 0.046 means is that sample proportions typically vary from the true proportion by about 4.6 percentage points. This is the typical spread we would see of our sample proportions from the true proportion by chance alone. So in order to capture 95% confidence, we need to go about two standard deviations out from the mean of a normal curve. And note that actually it's not quite two, as we've been saying all year and kind of lied to you about. It's actually more like 1.96 is what we revealed last time. So we need to go 1.96 standard deviations out from the center to capture 95% of the area in the middle. So I'm going to go 1.96 times that standard error out from the center, and I get margins of error of about 0.09. And what this means is that if we travel 9 percentage points below my sample proportion and 9 percentage points above my sample proportion, I get this interval you see here. So we are 95% confident that the interval from 0.08 to 0.26 captures the true proportion of homes in Flint with prominent lead. We're 95% confident that that true proportion is between 8% and 26% of homes having high lead. So do we have convincing evidence of violating the EPA rule? Well, we don't really, because recall, the rule states that if more than 10% of homes in the city have high lead, you are in violation of the rule and need to change your water system. But it's plausible that as few as 8% of homes might have high lead levels. And if that value is plausible, it means that it's plausible that less than 10% of homes in the city have high lead levels, and so the EPA rule is not being violated. So Dr. Edwards and his team might wonder, what's one way I could make my interval narrower? How could I do that and get more convincing evidence that the city is violating its code? We're going to look at different ways that his team could approach that, one not so great way and one better way. And we're going to start with looking at maybe lowering the confidence level. What does that entail? So let's talk about confidence levels and critical values. So in order to capture 95% confidence, we went 1.96 standard errors out from the center. But what if you want to just capture 80% confidence? So we're going to shrink the interval for 1.96 standard deviations out to a certain different amount of standard deviations out that's going to give us 80% rather than 95% confidence. So in order to capture 80% confidence, we don't know exactly how many standard deviations out we need to go. It's something lower than 1.96, but how much exactly? We're going to plug in a variable for that unknown amount, Z star. Z star is called the critical value for your confidence interval, and it tells you how many standard errors you need to go out in order to achieve a certain confidence level. So let's recall 95% confidence and really where that came from, that 1.96, where did that come from? Well, in order to capture 95% confidence, that means you need to put 2.5% of the area of this normal curve in each tail. And we're going to go back to our old friend, table A, which shows us the area under a certain z-score in a normal curve. And so in order to capture 2.5% below, we're going to look at table A and see what z-value gives us 2.5% below. So I'm going to look for that on this table. And remember, the numbers in the middle gives you the areas below. I'm looking for 2.5% or 0.025 as a decimal. So I'm exploring this table. We're at 0.0003. That's too low. 0.0026. We're looking for 0.025. So we're still low. And finally, we reach it here. So 0.025. Let's see what z-score that corresponds to by dragging it out to the edges. And we see here that if we look at the two margins of this table, we get a z-score of negative 1.96. So we need to go 1.96 standard deviations below the mean in order to put 2.5% of area in that lower tail. So I'm going to go 1.96 standard deviations out. And that means that in order to capture 95% confidence, or to put 2.5% in the tails, we stray 1.96 standard errors out from the center. So in order to get 80% confidence, we go back to table A and we think about what's going to put 10% in each tail. And specifically, we're looking for 10% below a certain z-score because that's what table A tells us. And the reason we have 10%, 80 plus 10 plus 10 gets you to 100, right? So from table A, looking for that 10%, you're going to see that corresponds to a z-score of -1.28. So I'm going to go 1.28 standard errors out in order to capture 80% confidence. So fewer standard errors out than when we were trying to get 95%, 1.28 is going to give us 80%. So we're going to go 1.28 standard deviations out from the center. And so I'm going to do 1.28 of my standard errors times my standard error of 0.046. This gives me a new margin of error of 0.06. So my new interval with 80% confidence is going to be from 0.11 to 0.23. Do we have convincing evidence of violating the EPA rule? Maybe. Well, look, I mean, 10% is outside my interval. So my quote unquote plausible values range from 11% to 23%. This might suggest that all the plausible values are above 10% and the city is violating its EPA rules. But we're only 80% confident in this estimate. We're only 80% confident that this interval actually captures the true proportion. So we're not really fully confident at like a 95% level, a usual level that we might use. that we're capturing the true proportion and that we have convincing evidence that Flint is violating its rules. So the team might wonder, how could I make my interval lower without lowering my confidence level? Lowering the confidence level seems kind of like cheating almost, and it doesn't really give you that convincing evidence. How can I do that in a more kosher way? And for that, we need to look at sample size. This is the better way to lower your interval size. So recall that in our mock example, we had a low sample size of only 66 homes. We pretended they only looked at 66 homes, and we got this standard error using that estimate of 66 homes. Now, our mock study only had 66 homes, but the actual Virginia Tech study, if you look at the data they had, they measured 252 homes randomly, and 42 of those homes had prominent lead levels. That gives you as well 16.7% of homes having lead level, high lead levels. That's the same as we had before, but they measured more homes. So higher sample size, same point estimate, same proportion expected or measured to have high lead, but they measured more homes. How does that affect things? Well, here's what we were looking at with 66 homes. Here's how it changes if you plug in 252. Note that we're still centered at the same place, but now the spread from my sampling distribution is lower. And because we're dividing by N, the sample size, if we have a higher number in that denominator, a higher sample size, my standard error shrinks because we're dividing by a bigger number. Our estimates become more precise. And so now, even with 95% confidence, my interval is narrower. We're going to get a more precise estimate, a more narrow interval. So now, do we have convincing evidence of violating the EPA rule? Yes, we do. All plausible values with 95% confidence are all above 10%. We're 95% confident that the true proportion is going to be somewhere above 10%, between 0.12 and 0.21. And so we have convincing evidence now that Flint is violating the EPA regulation. And we didn't sacrifice our confidence. We didn't cheat. It's still 95%. We just went the hard way and measured more homes, put that time in, and we have convincing evidence now. So a higher sample size, just to give you a bit of intuition, why does that sampling distribution shrink with a higher sample size? You're going to have more data points in your sample. And that means that getting an unusual sample proportion is going to be less likely because you're measuring so many homes that it's going to be very unusual to see a sample proportion of lead that's very unusual. It's going to be pretty close to that true proportion because you're measuring so many homes. You're getting more data. You're going to get a more precise estimate. To see the intuition behind this, think of an extreme example. Imagine you only sampled two homes. You can imagine that in some cases, zero out of those two homes will have high lead. And so you predict that 0% of homes in Flint have high lead. In some cases, both the homes you sample might have high lead. And so you predict that 100% of homes in Flint have high lead. And so you can see here with this low sample size of two, you get wildly imprecise, high variability estimates. So a lower sample size, you're going to have high variability. When you get a higher sample size, you're going to have more precision. So we're going to get less variability in our sampling distribution. Our confidence interval is going to be narrower. And this is the advantage of collecting more data. This is why you should collect more data if you have the means to do so. It's because your estimates are going to be more precise. So note, just a summary note for sample size calculations. The margin of error for any confidence interval is composed of two parts, the critical value and the standard error. The critical value is the number of standard errors you're including, and it just determines the confidence level. It doesn't determine the full spread, it's just the confidence level. How many standard errors are you including? For 95%, you get 1.96 standard errors. For 80%, we saw it was 1.28. The standard error measures the variability in your estimation process, the precision of your estimation process, and that's also part of your margin of error here. And this is the full formula. And note, we're dividing by the sample size N in our standard error, which means that the higher the sample size, the more we're dividing by, the lower the standard error. And that brings us to our discussion question for today. In reality, researchers have to anticipate the sample size they're going to need before their study even begins. What we did was we looked at margin of error and looked at the sample size that led to that margin of error. In reality, researchers are thinking, well, I have to estimate this proportion. I want to be this precise. I want to have a margin of error of only this percent. So how many homes am I going to need to sample? What should I plan? How many should I be sampling in my procedure? So let's talk about a calculation like that. Imagine that you're studying Flint's water. You're going to create a 95% interval for your estimates, and you anticipate that 16.7% of homes will have prominent lead levels. To get a margin of error of only 3%, if you want, your goal is to have a margin of only 3%, what should your sample size be? How many homes should you plan to sample? It's a bit of a challenging question, but I want you to try and figure that out before class. That's it for today's statisticians. We'll see you in class.